Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living. It is our hope that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. There are two different agendas present on the earth. One is based on love and the other is fear-based. It is a spiritual contrast of good and evil that pits God against a rebellious angel named Lucifer. This begs the question, which spirit is talking to you? The spirit of God or an unholy spirit? Jesus promised peace unlike anything the world has to offer. He doesn't want you to be afraid, but you do need to be connected to Him. This is accomplished by reading the Bible and familiarizing yourself with how Jesus thinks. Doing so will grow your faith as you realize that you don't have to live with fear and anxiety, because there is no crisis in heaven. God is on the throne, and He has a solution to every problem. This message is entitled, Getting Rid of Fear. Welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church. Today is April 24th. The title of the message today is called Getting Rid of Fear. Let's open up in prayer. Father God, as we're going to read your word here once again, we thank you for the fact that we have truth, we have your Holy Spirit, and as we read, your Holy Spirit's going to open up the scriptures to us, and we just thank you for what we're going to learn here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. There are two different agendas that exist here on this earth. And you would say, well, maybe there's more than two. Well, let's break it down. Let's keep it two. Let's keep it simple. There is the agenda that we have that's God's agenda, the Creator's agenda. This would be God the Father, God the Son, Jesus, God the Holy Spirit. Okay? They have an agenda. And their agenda is one of love and mercy and forgiveness. They're offering compassion. And the devil, the other agenda that exists, it's this game that I used to play with my children called Game of Opposites. I would say, what's the opposite of love? What's the opposite of, light? What's the opposite of this and that? And there was clear opposites. If we say light, it's darkness. If we say love, it's hate. If we say God, the opposite must be Lucifer. And Lucifer has, his program of he's bringing in the opposite of everything that God is about. So let's turn to Psalm 103 and let's establish what God's agenda is. God's agenda, as I said, is love and mercy and forgiveness and welcoming us to Him. So in verse 1 it says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits, who forgives all thine iniquities, who heals all thy diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known His ways unto Moses, His acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy." Now let's clue in here on verse 9. "He will not always chide, neither will He keep His anger forever." So within the Christian circles, we preach, God is love. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish,
but have everlasting life. But within that verse, should not perish, those words in there, there's a warning. And this warning simply says, as laid out here in verse 9, he will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. So that simply means that during our time here on this earth, however long that may be, if you get 20 years, 40 years, 60 years, 80 years, 100 years, whatever it may be, this is your time of love and mercy. But when your time on earth comes to an end, you can't say, okay, God, now I'm ready to repent. It simply means that you have a limited amount of time. Now, if I know that I'm going to live to 90 years old, I'm 45 this year, I've reached, let's say, the halfway point, and I say, well, I still got 45 more years. It seems like a whole lot. A good example of this would be a vacation. When you're going to go on vacation and you say, oh, I'm going to take 7 days off. And at the beginning of your trip, you're like, wow, we're on day one. Got so much time ahead of us. Day two comes in, day three. Next thing you know, you're halfway into your vacation. And then it's the last day. And you're thinking to yourself, where did all the time go? Well, it didn't go by any faster. It didn't go by any slower. It simply went and plodded along at the same speed that it always has done. And in that mindset, you know, when we look and say, well, I'm going to repent someday. Someday I'm going to do this. You know, I don't necessarily need God now. Well, you don't know what's going to happen. And so there's a warning in John 3:16. Yes, it's all about love, but it says that he will not perish, but have everlasting life. It is possible without Jesus. Let's come back now to Psalm 103, verse 10. He has not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his love toward them that fear him. And as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. I love sharing this verse with children because I tell them, all right, here's what I want you to do. Let's say this is the west and this is going to be the east. Now I want you to stretch your arms out as wide as you can go. So they stretch them out. I go, wider. And so now their arms begin going backwards a little bit because that's the only way they can potentially make it wider. Wider. And at some point they'll say, I can't go any wider. And you say, fine, so you've reached a limit. But there is no limit here to God's love. Verse 12, as far as the east is from the west. How far does that go? Well, it goes all the way around the earth, and then it circles back around and just keeps doing this. Okay? It's a circle. It's unbroken. It's kind of like a marriage ring, right? The love that I have for my wife, it's symbolized by a ring. And a ring is unbroken. It's circular. It just keeps going around and around. There's no start. There's no end. It just keeps going. And that's what the example we have here in verse 12, as far as the east is from the west. It's really, really far. Verse 13, like as a father pities his children, so the Lord pities them that fear him or respect him. Think about this now. We have this God. This God is our creator according to Genesis and in the Gospel of John chapter 1. It's Jesus. Jesus created humanity. Jesus loves humanity. Jesus wants the best for us. He wants to redeem us. He wants us to live an abundant life here on this earth. We see the agenda that God has. Now, in verse 15, it says this, or let's go to verse 14. For he knows our frame, and he remembers that we are dust. Dust. As for man, his days are as grass, as a flower of the field, so he flourishes. for the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. Can you go and tell me where a flower grew 200 years ago? You can only tell me the flowers that exist today. If you have a picture, you could say, well, it was at this spot that there was something that was growing here. See, things are perishable here on this earth. Notice that he doesn't talk about trees and bushes that have more longevity. He's saying a grass, a flower. Grass is fragile. If you stand on it and you grind it with your feet, or if animals come with their hooves, it starts dying. And if there's no water that comes, it dries up. And then the area becomes barren. And this is what it's talking about, is that we think of ourselves as having a lot of time here on this earth, but we don't really have a lot of time, not in eternal time. And so God wants us to understand, use the time that you have. It's short, but it's there. Use it. This is the agenda that he has for us. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, we see Lucifer's agenda. And Lucifer, he can try and repackage his agenda as much as he wants, but it's really uninspiring. Second Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear. Okay? God does not give us a spirit of fear. If God does not give us a spirit of fear, who provides us with fear in our life? Well, if we're playing the opposites game, who is the complete opposite of God? Lucifer. It's Lucifer that gives us a spirit of fear. God comes in and he says, I've given you power and love and a sound mind. Okay? Power is where we exercise spiritual power. That's the power that's, you know, in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It says that, you know, when the Holy Spirit comes down upon you, you shall have power. Power to do miracles. Power to speak in other tongues. Power to do this and that. And there's no limit necessarily to the power that God gives us. Now, this is not going to be power in the sense like you can do telekinesis, or you can read people's minds. You won't be able to. But the Holy Spirit can tell you what a person is thinking. We don't need to read other people's minds. The Holy Spirit can tell us what they're thinking. And that's the same thing. Okay? We don't have to be able to levitate objects. It would be nice, potentially, I suppose, to be able to do that. I would be able to make myself fly if that was the case. I could rise up and take myself other places. But, you know, that's not something that God has deemed us as necessary and wanting to have. Okay? So power is the gifts of the Holy Spirit. He's given us love. As we were reading in Psalm 103, the love that God offers us is this unconditional, all-encompassing love. It says, I know that you're a dirty pig that's been laying in the mud, and I love you nonetheless. And I'm going to take you, and I'm going to clean you up, and I'm going to remake you into someone that I want you to be. He's not going to destroy your individuality in the process. In fact, he's going to emphasize your individuality. You see, Christians are not mindless clones. We are all individuals with unique gifts and talents and abilities. We look differently. We think differently. But we all have the Holy Spirit. And we all have salvation. And this is that common unifying factor. And then the last thing is of a sound mind. You know, when the devil comes in and he brings fear into you, and fear can be a couple things. If you see a rather large dog running at you and he's snarling and showing you his teeth, fear can hit you. Okay, it's natural. When you're standing on a building and you're three stories up and you walk to the edge and it's a little bit windy that day and you want to hold on to something but nothing's there, and you want to see what's on the edge, but you got a healthy respect or a fear of heights. You see, it's falling is not the problem. It's the sudden stop that, you know, is going to hurt you. Okay? So there's natural fears that exist out there. The fear that we're talking about is the fear that says, I can't do this. I just can't do this. You know, God has called me to do something, but I can't do it. And so we come up with an excuse. Well, I don't have enough money. I can't do it because I have money. Or I don't have the talent. Or I can't do this. Or I can't do that. And so fear grips us and locks us down to the point where, who are we listening to at this point? Flip over now to 1 John chapter 4. There's going to be spirits that will be talking to you. These spirits can be the Holy Spirit of God, and it can be unholy spirit. It can be Lucifer and his minions. The question is, can you discern who is talking to you? 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof you'd heard that it should come, and even now already is it in the world. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That verse 4 was drilled into me as a child. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The world is not our earth. We're referring to Lucifer and his minions. Greater is God that is in you than he that's in the world. Verse 5. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world hears them. We are of God. He that knows God hears us. He that is not of God hears not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. So, who is ministering to you? Okay, is it the Holy Spirit that's ministering to you? Is it the devil that's ministering to you? If I was the devil, I'm not going to come in like the devil. I'm going to come in and I'm going to try and counterfeit God. The Bible talks about that Satan has the ability to appear as an angel of light. In fact, when Jesus is tempted in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4, what does the devil use? Three temptations, and three times he quotes scriptures to Jesus. The devil is religious. The devil knows scriptures. He can recite the Bible from heart. He knows it forwards and backwards. Now, just because he knows it doesn't mean he understands everything. But he knew enough that, you know, he was going to quote to Jesus when they're standing at the top of the temple and he says, throw yourself off, because the Old Testament says your angels will pick you up and undergird you lest your feet get dashed into the ground. He knew enough to be convincing. And so Jesus said, "It is written. It is written. It is written." He countered each time with Scripture. And so Lucifer was not able to be successful in his temptation. But for how many Christians have been waylaid by the devil? How many have been ambushed by him over the years? Seemingly, you know, they got scriptures and they say, "It's good." And you're like, "Okay, did you test it?" "Oh yeah, I tested it. It's good." All right. That's why I wrote here on the outline, which spirit is talking to you? Is it the Holy Spirit that's coming to you? Or is it an unholy spirit? Now, the position that I have with this ministry is a paid position. And so there's a joke that Pastor John shared with me years ago. He says, "Yes, you are paid weekly, very weekly." And, you know, it's a homophone, right? E-E-K, E-A-K on the spelling. And there have been times where I have been tempted to say, "You know, I could do things that could earn me far more money." And I had an experience yesterday that really brought it and sealed it home and reinforced what I'm doing with my life. I was listening to two guys talk, and they were sharing their vacation experiences. And they were talking about vacations that they had had in Mexico. And I've been to Mexico as well. I've just never been on vacation. The times that I went to Mexico, I think I probably went maybe 5 or 6 times. It was always on a mission trip. And I would spend my Easter break during school, I would go down and I would do missions. And we didn't go to resort areas. We went to the poor areas. Not like dirt poor, but, you know, poor. Like, there's no paved roads. It's a completely different lifestyle. You go down to these areas and you think to yourself, "Well, I thought that, you know, I was poor, but I'm way wealthier than these people are." And it's an eye-opening perspective. But we would go down, we would share our testimonies, we would do like a vacation Bible school for the children, we would preach in the evenings, and we would basically share what God is doing with us in our lives. Like I said, I didn't go to a resort. And so as I was listening to these stories of these two gentlemen, I realized all the money that they had spent to go down and have fun. And I thought to myself, I'm far richer than them. Far, far richer, because I have treasures in heaven stored up. That these are long-term investments that I am not realizing now, but I made a conscious decision to serve God back then. And I haven't seen the fruit of my labor, but I believe that, you know, you sow and you reap. And so as I was contemplating career choices and looking at my life, and I realized, yes, I don't have a whole lot of money, but what person can truly say, "I am living the life that God wants me to live"? Now, there may be a lot of people in this room that say that that's the case. Amen. But I am willing to bet that there's a lot of Christians that if they were honest, they would say, "Well, not really. No, 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 it's not true." So, choices and decisions. Now, I had written here something that I carried over from last week. Getting rid of fear. You know, I'm thinking about retirement. I'm not looking like I'm going to retire right now, but I'm thinking about it. And I'm thinking to myself, Will I have enough money when I retire or when I get older? Will I have enough? Well, if I'm looking at it honestly, I'm going to say no. I'm not going to have enough. And I'm okay with that. You see, because I'm living on God's economy. And God's economy does not have to make sense. It does not have to say all your needs are provided for. It simply says you walk with God and He takes care of you. Last week we were reading in Psalms when it says, I was young and I am now old, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. And so I am standing on the fact that in God's economy, as I walk with God and I do the things that He wants me to do, God's work done God's way will not lack God's supply. And that simply means that there is no crisis for me here on this earth. There's no crisis in heaven either. God is on the throne and He has a solution to every problem. And as I was thinking about finances, that still does not solve it necessarily. And so there's the opportunity for Lucifer, the devil, Satan, to come into my life and try and sow fear and say, well, what are you going to do about the future? What are you going to do? That's okay. There is no crisis in heaven. God is on the throne. He has a solution. I started a faith journey about 20-something years ago, maybe 22 years ago. I moved up here. I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do with my life. Along the way, God has opened certain doors for me. And so I can look back now at my faith journey and I can say, in the last 22 years, God has taken care of me. You see, that's faithfulness, to be able to look into the past and to say, God is on the throne. He is taking care of me. So when I look forward into the future, it is very much uncertain, and I don't know what's going to happen, and I'm okay with that because I'm serving God. I don't have to be fearful about the future. Now, does that mean that we should not plan ahead? No. It would be advisable to try and make plans and make sure that your plans also line up with God's plans. If we go down now to verse 16, it says, and we have known and believed the love that God has to us. God is love, and he that dwells in love dwells in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, as God exists, so are we in this world. When I stand in front of God someday and my body has died and I go to heaven, I don't have to be fearful. I don't have to be apprehensive. It is simply a time of joy to be able to look forward, to be able to say, wait for those words. Here they come. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. There is no higher praise any Christian can receive from God than to hear those words. And then verse 18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that fears is not made perfect in love. There are two agendas here on this earth, the agenda of love and the agenda of fear. Fear brings torment. It causes us to lose sleep. We lose our appetite. We lose our peace. It just robs us. It's basically like a spiritual cancer. And it comes in and it just eviscerates a person and cuts them up. Let's turn to the Gospel of John chapter 14. We're going to look at some select verses here. John 14:27, it says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Jesus is crossing the Sea of Galilee with his disciples, and he's tired and he falls asleep in a boat, and the wind is raging, there's waves, water is now beginning to wash over the sides, and the disciples just wake him up in a panic. Granted, most of them are experienced fishermen. They know how to handle a boat. Even the guys who are experienced are scared. This is quite the storm. And Jesus just wakes up and he says, "What's going on, guys? It's no big deal. Peace. Be still." And it says that the wind and the waves immediately died down. And this is what he's talking about here. "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Your soul should be at peace. Your soul should not be troubled. Your soul should not be scared. Your soul should be resting in God. And when we're resting in Him, everything is fine. Next chapter, chapter 15, verse 5. "I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me, and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing." Look back at the verse. It says, "Abide in me, and I in you." Now, let's go to a tree, and it has a branch that's growing. If I was to take a chainsaw and just cut the branch, and then take the branch and stick it back against the tree, and I let go, the branch just falls to the ground. It's lost its hold to the tree. But I would also argue that the tree has lost its hold to the branch. It's a reciprocal hold. The branch holds on to the tree. Tree holds on to the branch. This is the image that Jesus is painting when he says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me, and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing." We're connected to him. And then, chapter 16, verse 33. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Who is the world? The world is Lucifer, Lucifer's minions. That's his kingdom spiritually, and it's his agents physically living here on this earth. There are agents of Satan walking around here on this earth. Now, they may know it. They may be unwillingly part of it. Every unsaved person is an agent of Satan. And then there are the people who are hardcore in the corner of Lucifer. They know who they serve, and they are actively promoting his agenda. Jesus says, "Now, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace." Regardless of that, "In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." It is possible, Jesus was saying now, to have a supernatural peace. And a supernatural peace is what Paul is talking about in Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. We pick it up here in verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, rejoice. Let your moderation be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing. Don't be anxious. But in everything by prayer and supplication. Now, we didn't say, but in prayer and supplication, let your requests be made known unto God. It says, let everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. So that simply means that we say, God, I have an issue. I need you to take care of that. And then once we've presented it to him, we say, God, I now thank you for taking care of this. It's in your hands. You're in charge of this. I let go of it. It is possible to have supernatural peace even if you're having problems, because we can give things to God. Now, I can't tell you, I can't show you a mathematical equation of how that works. We can explain a lot of things here on this earth. We can explain things through mathematics and physics and chemistry. But there are some things we just cannot explain. We don't have the ability. We're missing input into this. This is one of those things, to be able to say, God, I am going to give you a problem that is greatly troubling me. I'm going to now offer it up to you. I give it to you completely. Jesus reaches down. He takes it. We take our hand away. We don't have our problem in our hand anymore. Whether the problem is solved immediately or not, and I would say that experience has shown me it's the or not part, it's not solved immediately. We're waiting. We're still waiting. The answer, you know, the solution might come some point in the future, but it's not immediate. And that's where thanksgiving now comes into play, where we just say, God, thank you for taking this. Thank you for taking care of this. Thank you for letting me unburden myself. Verse 6, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. The Apostle Paul, I like this example because I have taken this home to heart. I've said to my children now, the things that you see me do, you copy. The way that I act, the way that I talk, the way that I behave. If you see me jumping on the couch, you go ahead, you jump on the couch. You see me throwing a ball in the house, you go for that, you throw a ball in the house. But if you don't see me do those things, then you don't do those either. By my good example, do that. Now, occasionally, my flesh rises up, and one of my children with a sparkle in their eye will say, oh, Dad, we just saw you do something that you said that we should not do, so that means, you know, we're now good to go. And I say, yeah, I am. Okay. But it's with a sparkle in their eye that, you know, they get to say, hey, Dad, you're being a little hypocritical here. But I like what Paul says. He says, those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do those things. Paul said, I am the example. Look to me. Look to me. I'm living what I'm telling you to do. And when you do that, the God of peace shall be with you. So, is Paul the new Jesus? No, he's copying Jesus. Okay? Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, Hebrews chapter 12. Let's turn to Hebrews, but we're going to go to chapter 4. It says here in verse 12, for the word of God is quick. Quick is Old English for alive. The word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight. Manifest means to reveal. But all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. The Bible is like a fillet knife. I mean, it just slices and cuts things, and it cuts with precision. And that's what they're trying to bring out here when they say dividing joints and marrow, soul and spirit. They're drawing this parallel back and forth, and they're saying that the Bible is able to slice things, and it's able to discern your thoughts and intents of your soul, okay? Physically, spiritually, the Bible cuts through everything. And more or less, just like Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, after they sinned and they realized, we're naked. Okay? When you're naked, there's nothing that's hidden. Okay? Everything that you see, it's just instantly there. It's all revealed. And so the Bible says that when we read it, we're naked in the eyes of God. He sees through us. He knows certain things. He knows what you're thinking. He doesn't just know your actions and what you're saying. He knows what you're thinking also. You see, this is made evident when Jesus is hanging on the cross. And he has what the Bible describes as two malefactors, one on each side. And one man says, hey, if you're really, you know, the Savior, take yourself down from the cross, rescue us, and let's get out of here. And the other man rebukes him, and he says, look, be quiet. We're guilty. He's not. And then he says to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And this is where the Bible says that we're naked before his eyes, because Jesus looked at his soul. He saw his intent, and he said, this day you will be with me in paradise. He recognized that this man was repentant. He didn't say it. He didn't necessarily show it with body language, but it was open to Jesus. Jesus could clearly see that. And so one day we're going to have, as it says here in verse 13, with whom we have to do, we're going to face God. And we're going to be judged for the things that we did here on this earth. But primarily, we're going to be judged for whether or not we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Did you repent of your sins? Did you confess and say, I am a sinner. I can't save myself. Jesus, I need you to help me. That's going to be the most important thing right there. The job that you did, how much money you earned, your wealth, your fame, power, your riches and stuff that you had, none of that's going to matter. I wrote here on the outline, in the game of football, the best defense is a good offense. And it simply means this. As long as your offense is out on the field, the other team's offense is not on the field. That means that they're playing a defensive game and they are continually reacting to your moves. So whether you decide to pass the ball, run the ball, but as long as you just keep marching down the field and you score points, they're not on the field. And when they're not on the field, their offense is not scoring any points. Satan spent 3.5 years of the time that Jesus had in ministry reacting. He was playing defense for 3.5 years. Not once was he playing offense. He tried to do a little offense with the temptation of Jesus, but Jesus shut him down real fast. I want you to think about that. If you are playing offensively, it means that you're working with God. God is speaking to you. You're reading your Bible. You're doing the things here on this earth. You're living your life, but you're also doing the things that God wants you to do. You are playing offensively. Defensively, you're sitting. You're passive. You're waiting for things to happen. Lucifer brings stuff to you. Oh, this is interesting. That looks good. Okay, I'll take some of that. What we need to do is we need to be exercising faith. Turn to the Gospel of Mark. In the Gospel of Mark, we find chapter 11, and Jesus has cursed a fig tree. And then he went on his way. So now it's the next day. We pick it up here in 11, verse 20. And in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, says unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away. And Jesus says, have faith in God. I think this is kind of funny because we don't talk about ourselves in the third person. If I walk around talking about myself in the third person, somebody who does not necessarily know me is going to think that there's another Charles that's out here. Charles is hungry. Charles is thirsty. Charles is thinking about going out through that door, right? And they're going to start looking for this other Charles. For those of you who do know me, they'll say, why are you not speaking in first person using, you know, pronouns like I and me, okay, or my, right? So Jesus is speaking like in a third person here, and he says, have faith in God. This is God standing there saying, have faith in God. To me, that's kind of funny. And so he's saying, I cursed it. Did you not expect that it was going to die? Like, why are you surprised? Have faith in God. When I say something, that's it. That's all there is to it. Have faith in God. And then he says in verse 23, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he says shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he says. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you shall receive them, and you shall have them. You have to exercise faith. It's a faith walk. And this is why I was saying at the beginning of the message, I started a faith walk 22 years ago. 22 years ago, I could not look forward in time and say I would be where I'm at. I am where I am right now, and I can look back and I can see the hand of God in my life, and I can see how he's taken care of me, met my needs, brought people into my life, just taken care of me. The Bible talks about, you know, the sparrows, right? It says they don't sow, they don't reap, they don't store up things for themselves. And that the Bible says, but your heavenly Father takes care of them. Those sparrows are simply doing what they've been programmed to do. They keep doing that, and God takes care of them. You don't ever see a sparrow just sitting on the fence, mulling life, saying, I wonder if I'm going to have food next week. No, he just does the things that he knows that he needs to do. He's proactive. He goes out and he does it, and God honors his actions and blesses him and takes care of him. That is the essence of faith. You see, when Abraham in the Old Testament was asked to sacrifice Isaac, he didn't just say, okay, God, I believe. He had to saddle up a couple animals, take provisions. They were going to travel a couple of days. He had to take his son with him. He doesn't share what's going on in his head. But we can see through his actions that he has faith, that he believes that God is in control, that God has asked him to do something incredibly difficult, to sacrifice his son, the son of promise, the one he had waited so long for. And so, in the end, he just reasons, well, God can take him, and God can also bring him back. Okay? That's faith. It's walking in faith. Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 11. Now, there's a rock and roll Hall of Fame. There's a baseball Hall of Fame. There's a football Hall of Fame. There's Hall of Fames for lots of things. In the Bible, Hebrews chapter 11 is the faith Hall of Fame. This is not done. This chapter will be written, and there will be many more entries in there. But if you want to define what faith is, you can go to a dictionary and you can go look it up. You can also look here in the Bible. Hebrews 11, 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Very good definition. Verse 2 says, for by it the elders obtained a good report. The elders are the ones who are going to be listed in this chapter. They're the ones that lived a life of faith. It's introducing them. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaks. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death. And he was not found because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. That's God. For he that comes to God must believe that God is, and that God is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Okay? We have to step out. It can be difficult at times to step out and do that faith walk. Baby steps. A little bit here, a little bit there, and then your steps get bigger. Let's turn the outline over here. God does not want us to live in fear and anxiety. Okay? Today's message, getting rid of fear. Well, let's inoculate ourselves here. For Psalms chapter 91, it says, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. For I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence, from sickness and disease. He shall cover you with his feathers. He's drawing a picture here of a mama spreading her wings out. And under his wings shall you trust. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day, nor for the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come nigh you. Only with your eyes shall you behold and see the reward of the wicked. Clue in now. Because you have made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, your habitation. He's your stronghold. He's your fortress. He's your castle. You go in and you hide inside of God. You bring your concerns to him. He is your hiding place here at this point. Verse 10, there shall no evil befall you, neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. This is the part that Lucifer was quoting in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4 when he was tempting Jesus to say, throw yourself off the temple. They shall bear you up in their hands, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the adder. An adder would be like a cobra, a poisonous snake. The young lion and the dragon, the snake again, you shall trample under your feet. There's no one that looks at a lion and says, oh, that's harmless. I can step all over him as much as I want. No, it doesn't work that way. You step on the lion, he gets angry. He gets irritated and he says, why are you doing this to me? Get off of me. He has sharp claws. He has nice long teeth. He has a powerful bite. This is one of the reasons that in 1 Peter chapter 5, it says that Satan walks about as a lion. He's prowling. He's roaring. He's looking to tear you apart. Verse 14, because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. This is God. He's speaking to us now. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. I'd like to draw your attention to the page that's entitled, That's My King. This was a man named S.M. Lockridge. He died 22 years ago. I was curious because I had heard this recording. It's a transcript, what you have here. And I wanted to know a little bit more about him. Generally, you know, what's his name? And his background. His name is Shadrach Meshach Lockridge. So he's got some parents that knew the Bible. They knew the story of Daniel and his friends. He preached a sermon message, and at the end of his sermon, he wanted to describe Jesus to his congregants. And so I'm not going to take the time and read this, but I want you to read it on your own. Because he begins to describe Jesus, and he goes in and he says a few things, and then he comes back and he approaches it from another way, and then he approaches it from another way. And this is a man that's read his Bible. This is a man that's intimately familiar with Jesus. He's talked with Jesus. He's walked with Jesus. There isn't anybody who could say this as an unsaved person. Jesus is his king. So the question is, when you're looking at fear in your life, what is king? Is Jesus king in your life, or is Lucifer king in your life? Because if love is king in your life, there is no fear in love. And if fear is ruling your life, you're not made perfect in love. It's a dichotomy. It's opposites of each other. The two cannot coexist. It has to be one or the other. One pulls back and another one gives way. But there cannot be a peaceful coexistence. In order for there to be a peaceful coexistence, it means that God and Lucifer have to be working together. And that's just not happening. The Bible does not bring that out. And so this message is mainly aimed at Christians. But you know what? Unsaved people can be ruled by fear as well. Fear of dying, fear of failure, fear to go and do this, to talk to a person, fear, fear, fear. There's been a lot of Christians I've talked to over the years that as you get to know them, you realize, oh, they have a little bit of fear in their life. Oh, I couldn't possibly go and share my testimony with the church. I can't talk to people. I get locked up. That's fear. Fear is where you're holding back. Fear is faith in the devil. Fear is not faith in God. It's faith in the devil. It's saying, whether you know you're willing to, an unwilling participant or not, I'm with the devil's program here. I'm with his agenda. I'm not with God. There is no fear with God. God wants us to respect him, but he doesn't want us to be afraid of him. My children do not fear me, except when it's time for judgment. And they know they've messed up, and there's about to be a little bit of a spanking. They're fearful at that point. But other than that, what reason do they have to fear me? They run up. Hey, Dad, how you doing? They come up. They give me a hug. There's no rebuke. There's no pushing them away. It's the same with God. The only time that people have a reason to be afraid of God is when they know they've done something wrong. And they've embraced Lucifer's program. And now they know that they're living in sin. And God is not okay with it. And that's why they're afraid. But now they're serving Lucifer. Fear is faith in Lucifer. Fear is faith in an angel. A rebellious angel whose eternal position is in the lake of fire. Right now, he's powerful like an overlord on this earth. But his eternal position is in the lake of fire. This is why the Bible says, greater is he that's in you, in 1 John chapter 4, than he that's in the world. If you've never taken the opportunity to make Jesus Lord and Savior of your life, you really need to evaluate your spiritual choices. You might think, well, I'm healthy, I have a whole long life here ahead of me. That may be. But you don't know what's going to happen in the future. You're planning on living a long time, but is that how it's going to happen? I had a friend in high school. She was rear-ended and she died. She was not planning on dying. She had no thoughts about dying. But it happened. Fortunately, she had trusted in Jesus as her Lord and Savior. Did that make losing her any easier? No. But I could rest in the fact that she had gone to heaven. She is not perishing. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish." Okay? That means to end up in hell and later in the lake of fire. That's not God's intention. God's intention is that you should be saved, that your name should be written in the book of life, and that you will be in heaven with him for eternity. That's his joy. That's his desire. But it's your choice as to whether or not you accept his free gift. And I would encourage you to do that. Thomas, let's close in prayer.
Father God, thank you for the word, Lord. Thank you that you have given us faith, that we practice it and it grows and we are blessed. Thank you, Father God, for meeting the needs of each and every believer. We know that we don't have to fret about any of that. That definitely our needs are met. Thank you for the many scriptures that we got to go over today. They are the lifeblood of the Christian. I thank you for that word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking his commandments. That's why he said we've all sinned and fallen short of his standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends his love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with his shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that he sent his own son to pay a debt he did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send his Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers his love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, he will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, he will do for you. If you call out to him, he will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All he wants for you is to come to him. He will help anybody who calls out to him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, he will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Thorell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You've been listening to the weekly webcast. This message was entitled, Getting Rid of Fear. There are two different agendas present on the earth. God offers love, mercy, and forgiveness. The fear-based program of Satan puts your faith in him. It's a spiritual contrast of good and evil that pits God against the rebellious angel. Jesus promised peace unlike anything the world has to offer. He doesn't want you to be afraid, but you do need to be connected to Him. This is accomplished by reading the Bible and applying it in your life. Doing so will grow your faith as you realize that you don't have to live with fear and anxiety because there is no crisis in heaven. God is on the throne and He has a solution to every problem. The scriptures have the added bonus of building up your faith and highlighting the areas of your life that need improvement. Political leaders in the mainstream media use fear to hype situations and create the narrative they wish to portray. But the love of God is stronger than anything Satan and his minions have to offer. Which spirit is talking to you? The Spirit of God or an unholy spirit? This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1857. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.